Forum on SDGs for giving me this opportunity to speak today on impact on healthcare system by COVID-19. COVID-19 has shown us the weaknesses of health systems that have existed even before the pandemic, but which most governments chose to ignore. The pandemic has simply exposed the already existing fissures in our flawed development model. And the health system's response to the pandemic has only widened the gap between the haves and the have-nots, as I see it. While the rich could afford to pay for quarantine in comfort in hotels or get admitted in private hospitals when infected, the ordinary citizens had to suffer shabby, unhygienic and understaffed public health facilities. Public health in India is hugely under-resourced in terms of both financial and human resources. The Indian government spending on public health is around 1.28% of its GDP. And if we also add the private spending on health, then the figure stands at still a measly 3.6%. On an average, the high-income nations are allocating 12.5% of their GDP for health, while even low- and middle-income countries spend around 5.4%. So this huge disparity. The poorly resourced and weak health infrastructure actually crashed under the weight of the pandemic. Hospitals were simply not geared to deal with the crisis, and the sudden lockdown announced in March at a few hours' notice in our country did not give the health facilities enough time to equip themselves better. There have been many reports of shortages of medical equipment and patients having to share beds with each other amid unhygienic conditions in public hospitals. COVID-19 admissions warranted an attendant-less system, but public hospitals were not geared for it. And this added to the misery of many of them, especially the senior citizens. Healthcare facilities could not even protect their own staff. Insufficient or poor quality supply of personal protective equipment put a lot of healthcare staff at risk, and some even lost their lives. Yet they stood their ground, and commendable work is being done and has been done by our doctors, nurses and other healthcare providers who have braved all odds to save lives. Full marks to them indeed. Shortage of resources have forced the closure of many non-COVID healthcare services, as has been mentioned by the previous speaker. The OPD services were shut down totally in lockdown and have recently been revived but very partially operational. And most people requiring non-COVID medical care were literally left to fend for themselves. Children's immunization, maternal and newborn care, heart diseases, cancers, diabetes, kidney diseases. Treatment and care for all these have been badly affected. Also, tuberculosis and HIV. Women and girls were not only at increased risk of gender-based violence, but also pregnancy and abortion-related complications were left unattended too many times, as most sexual and reproductive healthcare services were badly jeopardized. One good practice example I would like to share here is of the community of people living with HIV. They organized themselves efficiently at a very short notice, and they started coordinating with various government departments even before the lockdown began to ensure uninterrupted supplies of antiretroviral drugs, and they did succeed to a very large extent. Then again, rights-based approach to healthcare was missing. Infection transmission was criminalized and people were profiled. Notices were put up on their houses announcing their status. And without any scientific basis or data, certain communities were labeled as super spreaders. This led many patients to hide their status or not seek medical care in time, as there was complete loss of trust in public healthcare, and private healthcare was out of reach for most. So this resulted in greater spread of the infection. The Indian government chose to hire a corporate consulting agency for advice on how to handle the crisis, while India's scientific institutions were literally sidelined. One example is the government's decision to open tobacco and alcohol shops even during the lockdown in order to earn revenue, even though there is scientific evidence that both of these increase the risk of poor COVID-19 outcomes as well as other life-threatening diseases, especially non-communicable diseases. COVID-19 has exposed the lie that free markets can deliver healthcare for all. Because despite all its weaknesses, it was essentially the public health system that remained at the forefront of fighting the pandemic, with private health industry at the just safe distancing itself or busy reaping profits. The pandemic has also exposed the poor coordination between different ministries, departments, sectors, and other stakeholders. We are not walking the talk on the tall claims of multi-sectoral responses or integrated development. The pandemic has made the world understand that health for all is intrinsically linked to social protection and social security. We cannot have health justice without gender justice, economic justice, social justice, and climate justice. It is the responsibility of the governments to ensure health for all. And it is also true for COVID-19 pandemic, where it is the fundamental duty of the governments to ensure that infection does not spread and those who are infected get the best standards of healthcare and social support in a rights-based manner, regardless of their ability to pay. It is high time we demand that profiteering from illness cannot be tolerated. Unless the rich and the poor alike use the same public services, including health services, we cannot work towards a fair and equitable world. And last but not the least, let us not forget that politics is the ultimate determinant of health. Thank you.